I'm now going to give you a profile of the 40 participants to the Notre Dame de Vie School of Spirituality May 15 to 29, 2013 class. There are 20 priests. Three of them are Monsignors. And in our group, I am Maria Luz Obolong, we have two Monsignors. They were Monsignor Romeo Violeta and Monsignor Glenn Corsica. There are 7 nuns of the 40 participants. 4 from the Theresian Daughters of Mary, 2 Carmelite missionaries, and 1 missionary of Saint Therese. Of the 7 nuns, I came close to Sister Esther B. Padilla of the Carmelite missionaries. There were 13 seculars. Secular order of Discos Carmelites, 5 of us, 2 Donum Dei missionary family, and others would include a judge, Judge Marlo Barrasales, John Tenchavez, Eugenia Blair, whom I got to be close with also, Maria Cristina Guevara, Divina Padilla, Lucia Juanita Pequinto. Now back to the secular order of Discos Carmelites, where I belong. In the video 2, we have a group picture of the secular order Discos Carmelites. So from left to right, we have Rosemary Rivera, then Elvira Boncawil. In the middle, the male secular, Carino Lonsagon of Ozamiz City, where my father, the late Judge Evaristo, was assigned as judge. And then Josefina Mendoza, and yours truly.
One Lord, and to welcome these tenets of faith, Archbishop Panlan started the starting gun yesterday for our path by saying that the Spirit works, especially to those whose hearts are open. And we were encouraged also by the words of Benedict XVI, we live to love and be loved. Our deeper vocation is to love. And in this path which leads to the mystery of God, it is hoped that we will deepen also our appreciation of the gift of faith as lived by the Carmelite family. Archbishop Palma cited specifically the recent doctor of the church, John of Avila, by saying that in the task of evangelization, the primary challenge is the holiness of the evangelizer. And for holiness, this would entail conversion. To have a new ardor, a new expression, a new method of evangelizing. And he cited the experience of the woman at the well at Sychar, how Jesus helped her to be more aware of herself, of her true identity, and of course of the water, God Himself, in the person of Jesus, that is being offered to her. But drawing from this well of living water would entail spending time with God to make us realize who we are really and what is our deepest yearning. So we need to learn to begin to listen to the Lord. The 3 key words for the evangelizer in this millennium, 3 C's: conversion, communion, commitment. Faith might be a response to God's call, but faith is also the door that opens up to welcome the outpouring of this love to which we are called. The love that transforms us and the love that eventually is expected by God to overflow by means of service to others. And so I make the segue to the afternoon session. Father Emmanuel reminded us of this vocation to love as the overarching scheme of what we are doing along this path. And he mentioned 5 points. What consoles us first is that we are objects of God's choice. It is He who started, initiated, we responded. And He called us to love in order to love. So whatever maybe our state of life is, it should be characterized by this scheme. He fashioned us out of His likeness. God, who is love, called us to love like He does. Love is our origin. We are created in love. To love, therefore, is our real identity. As Venerable Marie Eugene would say, our vocation is to live on love in order to die on love and to live on love eternally. Love, therefore, is the goal, not only the origin. And whatever we do, whether it be prayer or apostolate or whatever sort of spirituality, all this will be nothing without the perspective and the goal of love. And what about faith? Precisely, the path of love is to live in faith and by faith. Thanks to faith, we can have access to this invisible God who is love. Faith is not the goal, but it is the necessary means to welcome love, the love of God who is invisible. And this faith is also like the antenna, which makes us capture the waves, the invisible waves of the divine. Let us remember, God appointed us to bear fruit. And what is this fruit? Also love, charity. The dynamics of life is simple. You receive, and you give what you receive. You are called, you come. You are sent, you go. And this is our lifelong goal, to create an equilibrium of our receiving and giving, of our praying and our being sent into mission. Now I end by what Father Emmanuel has done. He has shown to us the faculty of this new spirituality. We know that the director is the Holy Spirit. The dean of studies is Venerable Marie Eugene of the Child Jesus. Our faculty will be the 3 doctors of the church and also Father Marie Eugene himself. And the exercise that we need to do while we are stretching and trying to walk is to multiply our acts of faith in the Holy Spirit, in the director himself, to deepen our faith in the active presence of the Holy Spirit, who is the only one who makes us really perfect children of God, who is love. And we end by asking the help of the Blessed Virgin Mary, who lived this life of love and faith to the full. And we ended the afternoon by realizing that we are not alone in this journey, that we are all travelers journeying together. Caminemos, Dios de Carmelo, caminemos para siempre. I hope that my recap is faithful to what they did, because there were many beautiful points. I want really to stop right now and just sit with you, because the heavy duty of continuing this path is now on my shoulders. I hope that you will pray for me as I do for you, as we listen and all receive this gift of the Holy Spirit. The topic is baptism. We fail, be satisfied, but also to well up outside of us so that other people will also benefit from what God has done to us. And this is the work also of our baptism. Whoever believes in me, rivers of living waters will flow from within him. This is a favorite quotation of Father Marie Eugene, the Venerable Marie Eugene, which you will find quite often also in I Want to See God, in his masterpiece in his book. So the great task, especially for Christians, is to make an inventory of our spiritual powers and place our hopes, not only those which we entertain for ourselves from a spiritual point of view, but also our hopes for society in these spiritual powers. So the task of whenever we commune with God, what do? We open the window and let the light in. Surely we will see many things when we open the window. But it doesn't matter. We might even see dusts in ourselves. We are not clean. That is the primary effect. But it doesn't matter as long as we are bathed in God's light. Because there we will know who we really are. If they will risk overshadowing this truth that we have, so we need to really tap onto this power that we have. It determines our eternal destiny and throws its light on the path we should follow in the world, the furrow we are meant to plow. We might say these are for contemplatives, Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, Teresa of the Child Jesus, Father Marie Eugene, and some of us were connected to Carmelite spirituality. Yet Father Marie Eugene asserts, it's not only contemplatives who need to be aware of these realities and to think about them. This is for every Christian, every baptized. In fact, this should be spread as good news to all human beings. Where do we want to go finally in our life? If not there where we can see God. Ultimately, what we will do is to contemplate Him. What is heaven? What's the point of our lives if not to gaze at God and lose ourselves in Him, the source and the end? Baptismal grace is something not new to most of us. But this session is only to emphasize supernatural truths which we already know and probably esteem, or sometimes we misunderstand. Father Marie Eugene is placing them in relief or relief, invoked in the full light of day, exposing them so that we may consider them more attentively, so that we will be more aware of our giftedness, of what we have, despite who we are. Or often, so that the esteem that we have for these realities, these truths, may be reasonable and proportioned to their value. Once aware of our baptismal grace, the seal it confers, the light it gives, the orientation it ensures along our path, and the hope it bestows, we will have a sure anchor in our life, in our society today. Not only for our being, but for our very soul. It seems as if despair cannot touch us anymore if we are aware of this, but we know that we are touched by despair. But our anxieties are somewhat quieted, because we rely on what God has given us. That God loves me. God gave me His grace in form of theological virtues. God caused me to go back to Him using these instruments. And finally, my undying, really great hope is God Himself, who gave me the little hope that I have in these theological virtues. It is God who wants me to reach Him. And why, you may ask? For His own delight. If I can find my joy only in Him, in God, He too finds His joy in me. And isn't the Trinity, isn't the Church, the locus of this joy in God? This is what our baptismal grace is. The object of our faith, the support of our hope, the food, the nourishment of our love. These are not my words. I borrow this from Venerable Marie Eugene, the Child Jesus. Thank you for listening. For your name, Jewish name. Masculine, Jesus, 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 Jesus
were
advantage. And yet, how about this icon? This icon played a very special part in the lives of Russians, especially in their homes. Whenever there is a wedding, there would be processions. There were processions from the house to the church and from the church to the house. They were holding this the icon of this Our Lady of Vladimir. So it was with them at the very start, the wedding, and also it is enthroned in the chamber, in the bedrooms of the new couple. And this lady have witnessed the conceiving and the birth of every child in every Russian family. And during the revolution, it has been burned, no? But not completely, as I told you. After that, of course, there was suppression, but still, the Christians there have hidden this image. They had compartments in the house, that whenever a visitor comes in, they would always greet the lady. They would open that compartment to see, to show it, and that would be the first one to be greeted. So, in spite of the many years of religious suppression, their faith were intact. Okay, the number two, please, slide. There. What can you say about that? Sabi niya nun, laki na ng mata. Takot ako. Mas marami pa ako nakakatakot. Okay. So, I can I love this. I have learned to love this. Hindi naman po ako mahilig sa malalaking mata. Pero, because of the meaning and the message. The iconographer has used the principle of frontality. Frontal, talaga po. Frontal face. Full face or three-fourths of the face faces the worshiper. Because a slight movement, I mean, it's like when it's no longer frontal, it means absence. So he is very present, frontal. And that's what we call the unlimited sight. Unlimited sight. He sees all. That's what we call absolute gaze. He sees all equally, simultaneously, unflickeringly. This is the perfect vision, and that's God. That's the quality of God. Only because God first looks at man, can man desire to look back at God. So I deserve to know ito talaga. Pero nung una, natakot din ako. Ito talaga ganda na ibig sabihin. The next one, please. Oh, this one. We can compare with this lady, Kuchiteria, very Byzantine. So it's more original, very Byzantine. And you can see the features are different, no? More rigid, and very severe, very empirical, because the child Jesus is clothed as an emperor. As a wise man. And then we will explain that later. And later on, that art of the mother and child, the Madonna, has been brought to Russia. And then there have been so many reproductions of that. And of course, as the painters had their own interpretations. Less rigid, more mellow, more human. especially when it came to Russia. Okay. So now, my dear friends, how did you feel about the icons, sister?
Huge.
for giving us, sharing with us the teaching of Venerable Marie Eugene of the Child Jesus. As you notice, we go to the presentation of Father M. He first presented to us Venerable Marie Eugene as a man whose 2 feet is in the ground. And that's how Father Walter started his talk. Nagsisimula sa life situation. Let us just give a talking or a teaching from above, but taking us where we are. So just to mention a few of what was said to us, he tells us that we live in a world which is disturbed and anguish. The situation. And further says that when we look at our history, it's the same. And until now, as Father Walter has unfolded the challenges of the Synod of the Bishop, it's the same. Disturbed and anguish. The world where we are. And yet, should we stay there? The windows and the door were open. The doors were open. When Father Marie spoke of the baptismal grace, the powers given to us by God, he said. So through baptism, we have moved from creatures to children of God. That's why we were so joyful. So grateful for this gift, this privilege given to us to be children of God. Venerable Marie Eugene tells us to make an inventory of our treasures. It is sad that until now, very few make this inventory. You have experienced, I suppose, by listening yesterday. You have it already. Sometimes we don't talk about it. Make an inventory of your precious, of your riches.
Development and
blossoming of the grace of baptism as children of God, as sons and daughters of God. So I'd like to follow this process. We should first have a reflection, self-reflection, in order to be aware of our what we think about prayer, what others think about prayer. When we speak of prayer, it's really silent prayer. A heart-to-heart exchange with God. And then hopefully, we have an understanding of who we are. Because prayer and who we are, and the identity that we have of ourselves, we help us accept why we have to pray. And hopefully, having an understanding of prayer and the role of prayer in our life, we have a renewed commitment to prayer. So three, reflection, understanding, and a renewed commitment to prayer. So this will have three parts. First of all, of course, the first part is the introduction, which I'm doing now. The last part is the conclusion. And the second part, so after the introduction, we shall ask, what is prayer? What is the role of prayer first in Christian life? The third is, what is prayer? And the fourth is, how to pray, learning how to pray. So I hope it's, we are already in B, looking into our hearts, self-reflection. What are some thoughts and questions that we have about prayer? First is, I have regular masses. I have the liturgy of the hours. Prayer is in our Christian life, our vocation to Christian perfection, which is the fullness of God. The Christian vocation is to reach the fullness of love, which is twofold, love of God and love of neighbor. I have not spoken here about when we pray, something in our message should make us also love our neighbor. It's not separate. Prayer is a person who is a man of prayer, a woman of prayer, is also a loving person, should be. If we are not, we try to show it's not us, but God transforms us to love also others. That probably will be discussed later. In the family conferences, like the fruitfulness of the apostle, see, that it is in certain sense. But at the end, our fruitfulness due to all these elements. One is prayer. So, I would like you to pray with me. So, first is, I try to help examine ourselves, including me. Do I think of prayer as something that should only be done when I have time, or when I need help from God, or something like that. And secondly, I have to know how important it is in my Christian life. And thirdly, what is prayer really? And then, how do we pray? So I'd like you to pray with me. This is the prayer of Blessed John Paul II. I was about to say, I am here in defense of prayer. I'm an advocate of prayer. You know, that is what Carmelite mission is all about. To lead God. To lead persons to the intimacy of God, to the ways of prayer. Which is not just to stay there in order to be an effective apostle in action. To be contemplative apostle. So, can we pray this together? With all our heart. So, please look up. Please sit properly. Students. And really pray this, because Blessed John Paul is also a man of prayer. All together. Lord Jesus,
teach us this extraordinary science, the science of prayer, the only thing accessible to all, the only thing which will transcend the limits of time, to follow you into the house of your Father, when we too shall be like him as he really is. Teach us, Lord. Amen.
Baptist. physically by silence, solitude, posture, regularity, constancy. Intellectually by spiritual reading. Spiritually by a condition of our faith, a constancy of our hope, a commitment of our love. And yet we are uneasy because as human beings, as we discussed, we were looking for concrete signs of God's response in this conversation. And maybe help us to bring back to the definition of Teresa, where Margie started. But at the heart of the definition is the relationship, the big win, this intimate friendship. And sometimes, some religion would tell us, the effect is not really good. There will be negative effects, antinomic. Perhaps the effect will be a greater knowledge of ourselves, our blemishes, our sinfulness, just like the publican in prayer. And so perhaps because of this, aside from charity, another fruit of prayer will be a greater trust in God, as a child beloved by Him, in an attitude of a greater abandonment, and looking and leaning on the Father, even if we find out that we are not worthy of this relationship. And so to greet also Father Itoy, who sort of capped also the top of Margie with his homily and his favorite song, we will be moving on to the top of today by singing "You Are Near." So, yeah, as they say, without much ado, I've been asked, I don't know exactly why, by Father M actually, to give something on knowledge of self, whatever that is. How it fits here, I don't know. Because this school in the summer is about the fact on the way to the mystery of God. But I happen to agree completely. Except from my viewpoint, to get near the human person is very much getting near the mystery of God. The more I go in page, if not in wisdom, and the more I read, I am more and more amazed by the mystery of the human person. So if we speak about a human person today, maybe more than God, it's good to remember we are a mystery, and it's totally unbelievable what happens in us. It's the fact is that we don't even understand much of it. And so it's a sort of a sense of wonder that we need to have when looking at a human person. Also as a pathway to mystery. Now, a long time ago, we have been told that knowing yourself is the beginning of wisdom. Well, also the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. By a good friend of Eddie Boyle, by Aristotle, the great Greek philosopher. So we go back a long, long way about the importance of the knowledge of self. But at the same time, we also have in Noir, by another philosopher, the most difficult thing in life is to know yourself. And this time, by another philosopher who's not so well known, although he lived before Socrates and before Aristotle, that's very serious. So, it's the beginning of wisdom. It's part of acquiring wisdom. But at the same time, it's something that is not so easy. If you move along the centuries, and if you go to the West, you know this famous Austrian German poet, Werner Meyer Rilke, who says, The only journey is the journey within, which can also apply to our journey. It's the journey within. The importance of living within ourselves, also in peace, in friendship, in harmony with ourselves. And there is an agreement if you go to the East. You know, as he's also a poet, that guy, sometimes he looks like a poet when he gets lost in the stars. I don't know what he's thinking about. In the East, I don't know if you ever heard about this amazing Christian activist, a Japanese, was very much involved in all forms of social action, who says something that I find very, very true. As a sculptor devotes himself to wooden stone, I will devote myself to my soul. I find this very, very concept. Actually, this Japanese author has this amazing concept. He said also the following, which probably fits this SOS thing. What is creation raised to a higher degree? Word love is central to this. It's like the creation that surrounds us. The creation of our own self is raised to a higher degree by love. In other words, love is what we are called to be. So here we are today, engaged in that. We are now in ordinary life, starting from this morning. And the question is, how close am I to the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit? You know these gifts. You will hear more about them tomorrow. Father Emma's promise that we would function as a group. We focus on the self and tomorrow on the spirit. And see whether self and spirit can ever go together. Wisdom, understanding, helps and forces to knowledge. Question that we have is evidently now, how can self-knowledge help me to grow and live in God's Spirit? That's our question. Not for the sake of knowing ourselves, usefully. How can self-knowledge bring us closer to God? Well, the quote St. Paul in this one, Paul says, let the Spirit direct our lives, and the fruit, singular, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, etc.
Shaped, at the same time, grow in our self-knowledge. It was beautiful how we linked this talk to the pathway, the theme of this session. We said, when we get near a human person, we get near the mystery of God. Then pose some questions, very important questions, which led him to discuss with us how can we grow in self-knowledge, how can this self-knowledge lead us to live our vocation, our dream, finally, the end. Then we spend some time in the worship quickly, but I notice we spend some time as a time by inventorying our human powers. We call it incredible gifts, our needs, the positive, and at the same time, it's limitations, not balance, and the emotions. Then, beautifully, in the afternoon, we had a chance to talk about this in our real self, in the apostolate, in the vocation, in the dream that we brought and some even what we would like to achieve in this world, our mission. And we can do that if we, during the sharing, again we saw in all the Thanksgiving, the tree getting nearer the human person. It's getting nearer the wisdom of God. Because they showed us that human person is a wisdom in itself. And now, for the next talk, can we open our songbook to page number 220? We'll sing that.
The path on which we are walking, we are not alone. It is not at all a solitary affair. We journey with companions, brethren, and I guess it was our common joy yesterday afternoon to be able to start sharing about things which are very dear to us, our dreams, and how good and precious it is to have brothers and sisters who listen to us and journey with us and pray for us, and for whom also we shall pray. This is the church. This is the net in which we have been caught. And it's beautiful. And we journey with the church here below on earth, but also the church which is already with us, but in heaven. And here we sit on the beaches of the little Teresa, but yesterday night also, it was a good time to realize that we have many Kuyas and Ates, the saints, to journey with us, to guide us, to comfort and encourage us. This is the church, and it is beautiful. And there is still someone who is all over, and it is about whom, about him that we are going to talk today, the Holy Spirit. He is our companion. Say, for my brother's womb, you are my God. You can address those words of the Psalm, Psalm 138, to the Holy Spirit. From my conception until 100%, until all eternity, you will be with me. How beautiful it is. And on some special days in our lives, the Holy Spirit came in. He's there since the beginning, but he enjoys conquering us little by little. For sure, on the day of our baptism, he came in a very, very special way. Giving himself, making of us his dwelling place, so that our bodies are, from now on, his holy temple. And then we could mention many special days in our own respective sacred story. Maybe on the day of our confirmation, the day of our first vows, and then maybe one of vows and perpetual confession, on the day of ordination, priestly ordination. On the day we receive the sacrament of marriage for those of us who are married. And then on Pentecost, he's already there, but he comes in a deeper way. It works like successive deepenings, successive outpourings, in the measure of my openness to him. So this is the Holy Spirit, and for sure we just celebrated Pentecost, for sure the Holy Spirit came in a deeper way. Those words of Jesus, if you who are wicked know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? I guess all of us have been asking the Father for the Holy Spirit. So, he was given to us last Sunday. And it's something which is actually ongoing. Yes, the Holy Spirit dwells within us. He is infinite, he does not change. What changes is my openness to him. My receptivity. On his side, we could say there is no change. When he gives himself, he gives himself. No, there is no halfway. The halfway is on my side. Because Siguro, I opened the door, but I'm a bit afraid. So I just open it. It's very narrow, my opening to the Holy Spirit. And since he is so respectful, he comes in the measure of my openness. You know, the Father Nigel spoke a lot about the Holy Spirit. A lot because you are speaking out of experience, his own personal experience of the Holy Spirit.